technology.
But actually, it is not only a React Native meetup. We will talk about what is native, what is cross-platform, pros and cons, and we will take a look in the 2020, what is the situation in mobile development world. I'm Güran Gülmez. I'm going to be your instructor today. I'm a software consultant with 12 years experience. And currently, I'm giving consultancy services to Unilever UK. Mm-hmm. Mostly, I worked on front-end technologies. Today, firstly, I'm going to give you a quick introduction about what is React Native. Then we will talk about prerequisites of React Native. Then we're going to talk about native versus cross-platform. It is an endless debate for industry. But before talking this comparison, we will take a look to what is native and what is cross-platform. We will talk about their own pros and cons. Then we're going to talk about cross-platform mobile frameworks in 2020. And as you can see, we have very powerful three opportunities here, Xamarin, Flutter, and React Native. And we're going to talk about React Native's architecture and fundamentals. At the end of the session, we will create a mobile option in Visual Studio. After this demo, you will learn environment of React Native, how to code with React Native, Android and iOS emulators, what is Flexbox concept, debugging and hot reload features of React Native. So, what is React Native? React Native is the famous motto, learn once, write anywhere. So you are learning how to write a React Native application, and with this knowledge, you can write both iOS and Android platforms with only one source code. It is an open source mobile application framework that is created by Facebook in May 2015. It is cross-platform framework. It can run natively on both iOS and Android. Natively part, natively keyword is really important here. React Native's UI is 100% native. It isn't creating their own UI elements. It is using what iOS and Android native applications create. It is based on React.js, so it is it uses JavaScript classes that extends the React.component. As you know, React.js is created by Facebook in 2013, and React Native is based on this technology. There are a lot of common parts between these two. So React Native also uses JS6 syntax. It is a synthetic sugar of JavaScript. With JS6, you can mix XML and HTML codes with JavaScript. Easy to learn, I think. And UI components are compiled into... are compiled into native platform specific component. So using React Native, and after you build, after you execute your application, your JavaScript elements are converting platform specific components in the background. So it is React Native. Target not only iOS or Android mobile devices, but also TV, VR, augmented reality, Windows and desktop applications, besides web applications, can be output of React Native. It is same in Xamarin and Flutter also. It is nature of cross-platform actually, because you are writing an application with a language, another language, a bridge, a converter is converting this language to platform specific. So it isn't important to which platform you are converting your code base. Real-world projects typically see 80 or 95 code reuse. So what is code reuse? Code reuse is really important thing. Yes, you have one source code base, you have one solution to your for your mobile application, but there need to write some platform specific code sometimes. For example, some codes are specific to only iOS platform, or some codes are only related with Android operating system. So yes, you are again writing JavaScript, but some of your JavaScript codes are only writing for iOS platform or Android platform. But its ratio is not so much, as you can see, 20 or 5 percent code will be platform specific. This is a basically a React Native code, and you can see output in the right side. Let's take a look to code. Firstly, importing React from React, as we mentioned before, it is based on React.js, mm-hmm. and you are importing some UI elements that will be used in the body of the code from that are get from React Native library, and a class, as you know, with ECMAScript 6 we have classes, extends react.component. Render function puts this code to screen. As you can see, here is this method, and here is a const that came to our life with ECMAScript 6 again. There is a URI, and in this section, here is a view. View is equivalent of div in web world, and text, hello world, as you can see, it outputs there, and button, title button, and image, source and styles, picture source comes from here dynamically. And that's all. And you register your component here to reuse it again inside other components. It is basically a JavaScript code. Hope you like this code. So who else uses React Native? Let me close the window. Okay, so as we mentioned before, Facebook and Instagram is already created React Native, and they are actively using React Native in their mobile applications. But who else uses React Native in the industry? Bloomberg is one of the lover of React Native. Let's take a look to their post about React Native, how Bloomberg used React Native to develop its new consumer app. Here is their post about React Native, and here is their application. Let's take a look fastly. Yeah, very stylish application, as you can see. So Tesla is another giant company that is using React Native, and I want to put here to their job opportunity about React Native. There are they want to React Native and Redux. TypeScript is a plus. And Uber Eats is one of the biggest company. And Skype, surprisingly, Skype used React Native in their mobile application. As you know, Microsoft has created Xamarin, actually bought Xamarin company and owned this technology, and they are investing a lot of resource to Xamarin. But there are a lot of applications that is using React Native by Microsoft. For example, let's take a look at these applications that is using React Native. For example, Microsoft OneDrive, Outlook, Microsoft Word, iOS applications is using React Native technology. And Android apps, for example, these mobile applications are using React Native. So Microsoft is a really big lover of React Native. Pinterest, Salesforce, GBS game is a football manager game. Wix and Walmart are another giants that is using React Native. So prerequisites. ECMAScript 6, that is known ECMAScript 2015, is a nice to have because it really improves code quality with arrow functions, classes, and let and const variable definition keywords. Really increase code quality, and basic knowledge of JavaScript is a must, and React.js knowledge is nice to have. Yes, if you know JS, if you know ECMAScript 6, and if you are familiar with HTML and CSS, you can start coding, but React.js knowledge will improve your development speed. And NPM node package manager, as you know, these frameworks like React.js, React Native or Vue is libraries, and these libraries using third party libraries again. For example, if you want to create a network request in a React Native application, you need to install a third party package. So NPM is using for that, very easy to use, but you need to know basic knowledge of how to install a package with NPM. These features came our life with ECMAScript 6. For example, arrow functions decrease code length. Here is old school JavaScript, and here is arrow function. There is no function keyword in this function. You are defining inputs with this parenthesis and with only one line, as you can see. And arrow functions are really funny and really easy to use inside these JavaScript functions like filter, map. It improves coding speed, and ECMAScript 6 classes, as you know, classes really important concept in C sharp and Java and other languages. So in JavaScript we can use classes too, thanks to ECMAScript 6. And const and let is again improved our code quality, because if there is a variable that is not reassignable, that is read-only, it is better to use const. And if it will be changed, second level variable definition keyword is let. If you don't want to use them, because if your variable is a global, unless this case, you should go to var. It is less powerful than others. So for ECMAScript 6, there were only var, and now we have const and let, and they improved code quality significantly. So cross-platform versus native, this debate separated industry because there are a lot of pros and cons. There isn't one general answer to this question, actually. We will take a look to their features a couple of slides later, but think about what is native and what is cross-platform. First, we need to totally understand native and cross-platform. Native is an application that is written only with platform-specific language. For example, if you are using an application to iOS operating system, you have to use Swift or Objective-C. These applications are native applications. Objective-C and Swift are platform-specific languages. You can't use this language, in another operating systems. In Android, there is Java and Kotlin. These mobile development frameworks, Android framework, and that is using Java or Kotlin, is again produces native platform-specific APKs, applications. So these are platform-specific language, and they have 100% environment coverage. When we look at to cross-platform, there are really powerful options here. React Native from Facebook, Xamarin from Microsoft, and Flutter from Google. They are investing really big resources to these technologies, and they are improving day by day. As you can see in this image, it is elder, native is older and powerful and really serious. But there are a lot of things to say from cross-platform to native. And let's look at this really interesting example. One of the company in the real world, they wanted to create a mobile application, firstly with iOS. They started to iOS, and because they don't think, they won't think they will need an Android application. They first think our application will be run only iOS devices. Then they completed this application with Swift language. After that, they want to create another new application to Android platform, same application in Android platform, and they know React Native and Swift, and they wanted to create this same application with React Native. As I mentioned before, React Native also giving native output. So it doesn't matter you are writing or React Native. If your developers know React Native, you can go for it. And they firstly created Swift, and after that they created Android application with React. And let's look at to their documents, their idea about this comparison. But as you can see, outputs are same. And as I said before, React Native already using native UI element, but with converters that is named to Bridge, it's converting these JavaScript UI elements to native UI elements, so output 100% same. It is really native. They calculated these numbers for us, for this company. It is really valuable chart, I think. React Native finished 1.5 months, and Swift application finished in 2 months development until production. Their pros for React Native are short support or convenient thanks to hot reloading. We will learn, we will hot reloading is really important. When I was Xamarin, hot reloading feature in the Xamarin, so to API. Yes, you can use APIs in very high level language, and Swift less allocated memory. Swift is, I said before, Swift is using, Swift is a platform specific language. It is language of Apple itself. It is platform dependent, so Swift can manage its own operating system's features perfectly. As you can see, it really uses memory very efficiently. Better support for iOS developers from Apple. Yes, if you are an Apple developer, iOS developer, you can easily select Swift. If you are an Objective-C developer, again, you can easily go for Swift. More effective in coding for native modules. Yes, it's platform-specific language, so it is very normal if it is more effective than all other alternative languages. Less dependent from third-party providers. As I mentioned before, React Native uses a lot of third-party components, a lot of third-party libraries. NPM Package Manager is already stands for that, to install other third-party libraries. And React Native only focus on writing UI and a little bit code behind logic. But Swift and other native languages are a complete framework. Everything is out of the box. So there is no need to install another third-party library, because if you wish, you can install, but I think a recommended one is always using native libraries if you are using native frameworks. Let's focus on to const, lack of wrapper for some native modules. React Native feature coverage of device. As you know, mobile, by the way, I'm going very fast, I think. Can you hear me? Is there any problem?
Mm-hmm. Yes, no. I can hear you.
Yeah,
sure, good, yeah.
As you know, our mobile devices very complex, has very complex hardwares, softwares. There are a lot of small micro hardwares inside our computers. So yes, Swift and other platform-specific languages has a 100% hardware coverage. You can write hardware to a you can write a software to each hardware of device with platform specific language, but React Native is relatively decrease this capability according to native components. It is not only related with React Native. All cross-platform technologies has more than 90% hardware coverage of device, but not 100% like native language. So let's take a look at this chart. First run, memory allocated in React Native is double of Swift. Again, when a user start to a call, it takes more than, again, native. And opening URL from app, it again doubles of Swift. And frame per second for different two screens, frame per seconds are same. So UI performance is really same, but memory allocation is double of Swift. Yes, our devices are really powerful until maybe 5 or 6 years. Maybe we will not make a difference when using these apps. But if you are using this React Native to develop a game, that, as you know, games are really active UIs, and once you user click to screen, this action immediately should be resulted. So if you are using React Native, this memory and CPU performance, according to it is a little bit lower than native technology. So if you are developing a game, you will feel a little bit delay in React Native applications. So general idea is, if you are a game developer, it is better to use platform specific language. It is not related with React Native, it is related with cross-platform technologies. This chart, these numbers, this comparison actually is not only related with React Native and Swift. This comparison is really close to other options. This comparison is cross-platform versus native comparison actually. So briefly, cost in native apps, high cost of deployment, because with React Native you can run, you can write once, and this code runs in two different platforms. But native, really high development cost. And code usability works for a single platform. If you are writing for native apps, you have to write same project twice. But cross-platform, single code base, multiple platforms for easy portability. Device access, as I mentioned before, platform-specific language has 100% hardware coverage. UI consistency is better in the native technologies. Performance, cross-platform apps relatively decrease performance, relatively lower, slower performance. If you are developing games, you will feel these differences. But if you are using a bank application, or if you are using e-commerce application, probably you will never feel any difference between these applications. So, conclusion, end of debate. In which scenario you should choose native, or in which scenario you should choose cross-platform? Do you need to make an iOS-only or Android-only app? So, if your applications, if your application will run only iOS device, go native. otherwise directly go to cross-platform. Do you have a small team with limited time and resources and need to make an app for both platforms? For small team, limited resource, go cross-platform. Do we need to make a high complex app which utilizes a large portion of platform-specific code? In the beginning of this presentation, I mentioned that there is a shared code and platform-specific code. So if your platform-specific code is too high, you will lose advantage of cross-platform, because the advantage side of cross-platform is cost and one code base. If you write iOS-specific and Android-specific code with React Native, you will lose advantage of cross-platform. So it is better to go native in this scenario. For example, let's think about Apple created a new phone and there is a new hardware in this phone. If you write this application with React Native, you will write only for one platform and you will lose advantage of React Native in this scenario. Do you plan to maintain the app over a long period of time without fear of Facebook quitting React Native? I'm not sure it is possible or not, but fear is fear. So in this scenario, you should go to native. But if you think about my application will be live more than 30 years, and I don't want to take any risks about a technology. Yes, iOS and Android gives maybe looks more guarantee solutions. I don't know. Do your developers have a strong React or web development background? Go cross-platform because a React Native React.js developer can easily switch React Native. There are a lot of common features, common behaviors in this two technology. Does your app need to support new mobile OS features as soon as they are released? When Apple created a new version of operating system, platform-specific language will directly support these features. But React Native, Xamarin, and Flutter will develop these features after Apple or Android release this technology. So some of the companies have to wait a couple of months maybe. So if you want to develop for these new features as soon as possible, better to go native language. Is your app going to look and behave the same on both platforms? You have for example, you are working for a bank and you have a banking application in iOS and Android. As you know, tabs on Android is at the top, and tab buttons of iOS is at the bottom. So some of the UI elements visuality is different between iOS and Android. If you want to have same visuality in both iOS and Android, it is easy to use React Native or Flutter. So in this scenario, if you want to manipulate native UI, and if you want to change native UI, native behavior, you can do it easily with cross-platform technologies. So Cross-platform app development frameworks in 2020, we have really powerful three alternatives: Flutter, React Native, and Xamarin. Flutter is developed by Google, React Native from Facebook, Xamarin created by Microsoft. Performance, Flutter's performance is amazing. React Native is better than Flutter, a little bit better than Flutter, close to native. And iOS and Android, Xamarin is less than others. Popularity, Flutter's popularity increasing day by day, like React Native, but Flutter is the leader in this criteria. Very strong, strong Xamarin's. I think its popularity is decreasing in these days. The development language, Flutter is using Dart. This language is using by Google itself for operating system development. And I never wrote with Dart, but I saw, and it is, they say, easy to learn. And my developer friends is really happy to write with Dart. So there is no reason to fear about that. React Native is the most, is using one of the most popular language. So I think one of the biggest advantage of React Native is using JavaScript. And majority of web developers is already knows JavaScript. And Xamarin is using C Sharp and XAML. Components, Flutter has its own UI component set. Flutter's output is not native. Flutter is using very stylish, very beautiful UI elements that is written by Google. And users generally users likes applications that is written by Flutter. They are really really fancy UI elements that I saw examples and looks really good. React Native use native UI. Xamarin use native UI. Same with React Native. Xamarin. Yes, you are writing C Sharp with XAML, and your XAML codes and C Sharp codes are converting native UI components like React Native do. Code reuse. In this criteria, leader is Xamarin, second one is React Native, and third one is Flutter. You don't need to write platform-specific codes if you are writing Xamarin or React Native. Its percentage is low. Flutter is not bad, by the way. Pricing, they are open source applications. So this slide is really important. Let's dive into these trends, and we will understand, we will analyze current situation about popularity. We have React Native, Flutter, and Xamarin. It is search trends about programming criteria in United Kingdom last 12 months. I put to Ionic here because Ionic is still in use in the industry. Ionic is not cross-platform framework. It is a hybrid framework. Basically, they are using this kind of hybrid frameworks, are using web views, and they are looking like web native mobile applications, but they are not native. They are using HTML5, JavaScript, CSS. But before cross-platform technologies, they were really popular. As you can see in the United Kingdom, React Native and React Native is the first one, Xamarin, Flutter, and Ionic is here. Let's look at the world. React Native, Flutter, Xamarin, and Ionic. Here you can see Flutter's popularity is increasing, and sometimes it is decreasing. So it is search trends. Let's look at to IT Jobs Watch. Let's look at to market. Which one is the leader right now? Let's get to contract IT jobs. Currently, rank of React Native is this. It increased 100 step according to last year. Contract IT jobs. It is Flutter. It is increased pretty much. And here is Xamarin in the UK. As you can see, it's not increasing so much, so it is giving his popularity point to Flutter, I think. But again, as I said before, these three companies, Microsoft, Google, and Facebook, always investing these three important technologies, and their popularities are changing day by day. For example, in Xamarin, as I mentioned before, there weren't a hot reload feature 1 year ago, but now they announced their hot reload feature, so I think it will improve their popularity day by day. But as you can see, again, the most popular cross-platform framework is looking like React Native. So if you want to work for a mobile development company, React Native is, according to current situation, it is it really increase your chance according to current market ratios. So if you have time, it is better to take a look at this technology. So I think, and there are a lot of job advertisement currently, so it will increase your chance, I think, if you add this technology to your CV. Let's dive into React Native's architecture. It is a little bit different architecture than native, because as you know, we are writing with JavaScript and we have a native UI element. So how this technology can success this thing? Firstly, this is JavaScript code. It is React Native environment, and with Bridge, Bridge takes this JavaScript code and merge this code, match this code to iOS equivalent and Android equivalent. So there are three different layers when we are using React Native applications: native layer, bridge layer, and JavaScript layer. Once user click to a button or send another event to backend, a thread collects data and notifies this data to bridge level. And bridge level takes this native behavior and converts this behavior, native behavior, native click event from native UI to JavaScript equivalent. Then JavaScript thread get this pass from bridge and gives this pass to related JavaScript function, and this function updates its own JavaScript UI. And this JavaScript UI element again goes to bridge level. Bridge again converts this JavaScript code to native UI element, and native gets this UI element code and process it, then updates screen. There are three different threads in React Native applications: UI thread, native module conversion. It is here. It is in the bridge level, and JavaScript runtime. These two threads are running asynchronously. UI is the fastest thread, and it is synchronous. So there is always a flow in React Native applications. So with this threading model, it is relatively faster than Xamarin. As you can see, in the UI thread works in the screen, and clicking operation is handled by UI thread, and with bridge, this UI triggering event passed to JavaScript thread. JavaScript thread converts it to JavaScript code, as you can see, and take some action with this event and pass again to UI thread to update screen. Basically, React Native architecture is like this. So if you write a view with JavaScript, iOS equivalent will be UI view, and Android equivalent will be view group. So you are writing view, and conversion will be like this. Now we will dive into coding features of React Native. Component is a very core concept in React Native. It is a piece of the UI. A component is essentially a view that can contain subcomponents. These nestable, reusable components are at the heart of the React. Once you write a component, you can use this component inside other components. They are all reusable. They are stateless. There are two kinds of components. First one is core component, other one custom components. Core components is out of the box components. React Native UI component, if it is view, bridge converts it view group, as we saw previous slide, and iOS equivalent is UI view. In web technology, it is div. Text will be text view in the Android, iOS view, UI text view. It is P in the web analog. Image will be converted like this, and scroll, as you can see. Custom components are the components that are creating by developers. You can use, for example, let's jump into this code. Here is a function component, cat, and this cat component is using two other core components inside itself, and cat is used by another component, cafe, and it is reused three times inside a core component. And this is output. JSX JavaScript XML stands for JavaScript XML. It is really easy to write, and as you know, generally less code is more quality code. Without GSX, it is three times longer than GSX version. So better to use GSX if you are writing JavaScript, if you are using React Native or React. Process state. These special keywords are really important and must to use if you are writing React Native. With props, you can pass variables to other component by component. And states are the properties that you generally bind to screen. For example, let's look at this example. Here is cat name. It is prop. Yeah, it is props, stands for property, by the way. Here, as you can see, name, bootstrap. At here, you can take this name with this props name. So, cat is a custom component. Coffee is another custom component. If you want to pass a value from parent component to child component, you will use this dot props. As you can see, name here, it is parent component that is using child cat. This is cat component, you can take this one. State works differently when compared to props. State is internal to a component, while props are passed to a component. If you want to change state value, you should use set state. If you use set state and if this value change, UI will change automatically. But it is not same for props. You can't change props values. If you want to change some values, you can assign them to variables and you can write your algorithm, but props values is immutable and states are mutable with this function. If you use set state, it will trigger to render method to be executed, and this render method will update the UI with set state function. Networking is another very important thing for applications and web world. You can use fetch, as you know, it is ECMAScript, JavaScript feature. And you can use fetch like this. You can write post methods like this, fetch, URL method post and header. You can use async await functions, async await features. Here, await fetch, it takes this JSON from this resource and fetch JSON object from this result and takes movies element from this JSON file, and there is exception handling here. You can use other networking libraries in React Native. XML HTTP request library is really important in the networking libraries because some of other third-party libraries like Axios are using XML HTTP request object as an input. So it is really important for each framework. They can use, they have to use this library. And WebSocket support is really good in the React Native framework. Style, with React Native, you style your application using JavaScript. Here is JavaScript codes, and they are looking like CSS, I think. Margin top, level, font, they are all JavaScript codes. All of the core components except a prop named style. As you can see, here are core components, here are style, prop, and there is an input. Input is const dot red. Red is here. And this value goes to this prop, and this core component change itself according to this value. It is like a JSON file format, as you can see. The style names and values usually match how CSS works on the web, but names are using camel case. For example, background color in web, in React Native, it is camel case, like font weight. For example, let's take a look at this big blue then red. Here is merged two style. Big blue is here. Font size is 30, as you can see, 30. Then color is blue, but second one overrides that and turns this thing to red. JavaScript styling is like this in React Native. Flexbox is really important concept when you are developing a UI in React Native. It converts to your screen, your piece of UI to a stack. For example, here is three different core components that is written one by one, and like a stack, it puts firstly a red one, then blue one, then green. Flexbox come from web environment actually, but the difference between web Flexbox and mobile Flexbox is in web, default orientation of Flexbox is horizontal. Yeah, you will see me according to this UI, it is again horizontal, but flex direction is changed. Default value is column in mobile applications, because it is very normal, as you know, mobile development is generally is a top-down architecture, but in web, in the computers, laptops, we have a lot of empty fields at the left side of the page. So the reason of this difference is this. Let's focus on these differences. Justify content attribute is flex start, so it aligns items to left pane, and flex end, it aligns to right center. Space around puts empty spaces between UI elements, and half of left, half to right space between, and justifies element to beginning and end, and puts same gaps between element, it's space between, as you can see. Space evenly puts gaps to every part of this row.
Gürhan, can I say small things? Guys, normally we finished our time, but we will continue and we will finish this application. If you have any other event or other things, you can leave, but we will finish it. I wanted to say these things because we are on the so important part. We are very close to the final project. Yeah. Okay, Gurhan, you can continue. I just wanted to say this thing.
Okay, thank you, Rasim. Other component libraries. If you want to have a really, really professional view in your mobile application, if you want to reuse UI templates, UI elements, there are a lot of opportunities in the market. For example, React Native Elements gives ready-to-use UI templates. They give whole page to you. For example, here is ready-to-use template. For example, here is top, and here is another view layer that there are a lot of small pictures and ready-to-use. You can, these are all JavaScript codes they give you, and you can change these codes according to your needs easily. But generally, you don't want to change this professional design. You want to, generally, you want to only edit some fields. So after this usage, your application will be will look very professional. I used a couple of UI kit like this, and generally they really decrease your development time, because generally their bugs are solved, and these are all professional designs. As you know, designing is another capability. Yes, I like to design screens. I want to play UI design for long hours, but there are a lot of things to write, as you know. We have a lot of Jira tickets to complete. So generally, it's better to reuse this code. And Material UI Kit, another very stylish. You can use these buttons, for example. It is like Bootstrap. There are a lot of opportunities in the market. So setup to write React Native, you need Node.js and VS Code, Xcode, and Android Studio. If you are using Apple, if you need to write a iOS application, if you need to run your application in an iOS emulator, you need an Apple device. So you need to download Xcode. But if you will write only for iOS emulator, you can run your applications in Windows machines. I will demonstrate you how to test your code in iOS phone in with writing Windows machine. So let's we will understand now how React Native is running inside Visual Studio Code, and we will understand to use emulators. Firstly, let's open to Android Studio, and we will use Android Studio to open emulator, and we will write our code in VS Code. Yes, we need Android Studio for emulators, as I said before. You can add an Android emulator with this button. There are ready-to-use emulators, as you can see, in different size and different resolutions. After selecting, one of them. You can download Android version. We have an existing one because it is taking a little bit time to install and run. These emulators are really powerful and useful, but there are some bugs, I think, in Android emulators. So sometimes we are facing with different errors when using Android emulators. So here is our development environment, VS Code. As I mentioned in this page, Node.js, I already installed Node.js, I installed Android Studio and VS Code. There are some beautiful extensions for writing code easily. Prettier gives us colorful coding environment. For example, Prettier gives this code different colors, and there is ready-to-use code formatting opportunity in the Prettier. You can install these extensions at here. Prettier code formatter, as you can see, it is very, very popular. I'm using it. And it is a little bit industry standard. So let's create our first React Native application. Let's say it Nux demo. This code will establish a development project for us and asks, do you want blank with JavaScript? And there is a TypeScript support in React Native, like React.js. Tabs, minimal selection, bare selection contains some platform specific folder structure. Let's go to blank project. It is downloading and extracting project files. There are a lot of third-party library. There are some libraries about React.js, and it is installing JavaScript dependencies. Here is our emulator. Let's go to this app. Yeah, it is downloading. It created our folder, solution folder. It will take close to 300 megabytes in the memory. So it is taking a little bit time. As you know, it is a cross-platform technology. You are writing an application with JavaScript to iOS and Android. So its framework is a little bit weak. So your project is ready to use, and there are some tips: npm start, npm run Android, run web and iOS. Let's look at to file size, empty file size of an empty project. Yes, size on this disk is close to 300. So let's execute to our application. NPM start will establish our connection to device and it will run our application. But first, to run our application, let's look at to project structure. This is, let's dive into project and open project from here. You can open from here. Yes, there is an assets folder. We will put our images, videos, sound, for example, files to here. If you want to, if you want to develop a push notification functionality to your mobile application, and if you want to change your push notification sound, you can use your custom sound files, and you will put your sound files to a set folder like icon and other things. Here is Node modules. It downloaded all of them. Babel is merging everything and creating a mobile application. There are a lot of third-party components. There are something for debugging and React and React Native Jest components are here, and here are React Native, React JS, React DOM, React itself libraries. As we mentioned before, it is based on React. So this is package structure. AppJSON is a configuration file. Here are our platforms that our native React Native application will support, and here is our application's version. Here is default orientation. Here is application icon. And AppJS is the our main component. It is a kind of custom component. Let's look at to our AppJS file. It is importing React, and we say to compiler we will use stylesheet, text, and view components. If you want to use, for example, a button, you have to import it before use it. And here is container style JavaScript code. So it is basically our application's default coding. So let's open to internal terminal. We have a terminal feature in .NET. And let's execute our application runtime. npm start will establish our application runtime. And we have a web interface to tell our React environment in which platform we will test our application. iOS simulator, we can't use it because it is not a Mac machine. We can run in web browser or run on Android device emulator. So it asks here, press A for Android emulator or W for web. I will press to A because we have Android emulator. Here is our web UI It's updating parallelly. Here is it is downloading building JavaScript bundle. It is merging third party components. It will do this thing once, and after each development, after each change, we will only press Control S. We will save, and our new features will immediately visible in the UI. But for the first time, it will take a little bit time. By the way, there is an application. Its name is Expo. If you download Expo to your iOS Apple telephone from Apple Store, if you open to camera and if you show your phone to this QR code, this application will appear, will be downloaded from your device immediately, and you can test your applications with your phones. I think it is really important feature, and it really increase your development and test speed. The title prop of a button must be a string. Okay, so I will delete this one firstly. Title property was empty, so there is an exception about that. If we set to title property, there will be no problem, but I want to demonstrate you to default behavior of an empty project. Yeah, as you can see, here is our default view of our application. We can see this code in the UI. So let me demonstrate you. I will use Expo application to run on my Apple application. As you can see, let me. Can you see my screen, Rasim?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay, I will open to camera. I open to camera and it says open in Expo. I'm clicking this one and it will directly open to it is downloading the JavaScript application inside my phone from Expo server. For the first time, again, it will take a little bit time. As you can see, it is on progress. And 50% is already completed. For the first time, it will take a little bit time. Sure, it is related with our laptops or PCs performance. If you have a powerful computer, this process will be faster. So it is our company laptop, so it will decrease a little bit performance. By the way, to have this feature, your laptop's connection and your mobile device connection will be in the same network. If you use another network, you can't use this feature. And it will, it is taking a little bit time. I don't know the reason. This is taking longer than it should. It messaged this. So, okay. Let's wait to this feature. I will demonstrate you as soon as possible when it completes its process. Let's write some code. For example, here is, for example, we can change this. And after we save, it directly affects UI. We didn't press any build or clean or anything. Then let's, we need always a root element that have to put in a root element like div. For example, if you put second view in the same same level, it will throw an exception. So there should always only one root element in our UI. Let's put an image here, for example. And let's give image. So if you use a core element, core component, we have to put this core component to here. So I pressed Control S, so it will throw again an exception. And let's here is a website that generates photos dynamically, and I will use this URL to download photos. So let's put this photo here. If I save down this thing, it will try to put our photo, it will try to download our photo to here, but it can't fit this photo to the screen because our React Native mechanism don't know height and width of the photo. So we have to give height and photo height and width values to fit to screen. So as you can see, it downloaded a photo here. If I increase to size to that one, it will directly put here. As you can see, here is our iOS test phone. We can directly use iOS device. For example, I will change size again. And after saving, directly updates Apple phone with Android mobile device. I think it is really, really important thing for developers because there are a lot of device specific bugs in mobile development device specific case are really painful for developers. So this testing feature is really makes everything easier for us. And let's by the way, there is a style that is created by default. Here is style sheet create style container. So here is style container, and it is flex one. Background color is, let's put it here, orange. And align items center, justify content center. And as we mentioned before, flex direction is default is column. So let's, if we put here another, for example, a button, if we put this button below this image automatically, yeah, as you can see, let's put another button. In React Native, its development style is a little bit different than web. You can't give margins or paddings to some UI elements. For example, a button is like this. You can't give a button to margins or paddings. You have to use another UI element to do that. View is the way of give buttons padding or margins. I will use a div here. So I want to use another div, and I will change flex direction to horizontal to vertical. Let me add another IntelliSense shows us options. Default one is column. We will choose row. And we will use again this code here. So let's give margin top to this button group. And let's use flex property. Flex is really important because flex gives ratios. As you know, there are millions of different devices and different resolutions, different screen sizes. So if you give flex to one, it covers whole screen. If you give flex to 0.5, it will covers half of screen. So your application will fit to screen without any platform-dependent future. So usage of Flex is really important when designing screens. Let's use another style here. Again, I'm using camel case. I will tell Flex 0.8, and for button group I will use 0.2. So let's use this style here. Yep. Let's let's use dimension library. To pick screen size. So we will use this screen size to fit image to screen. Here is our choices. We want only screen, and I want to give height dim.height and dim.height. Dimensions is here automatically, and yep. It fit to screen. Let's increase. Okay, looks good. And here is two buttons. By the way, Rasim, I'm keep continue. Are you okay?
Yes. Yeah. You can continue. Yeah. And you know, when you finish, we will do also 10 minutes question and answer session. Okay.
Okay. I will.
Thank you.
No problem. Let me use my phone to take this thing into my phone. It's downloading. Yes, as you can see, here is iOS version of this UI. As you can see, default behavior is different. Buttons in Android and buttons in the iPhone is different. So you can easily see we put a button, a JavaScript button here, but behavior, visuality is different in iOS and Android. This is really important thing. Bridge converted this button to Android equivalent and iOS equivalent separately from each other. So these are again need to be separated, I think. It looks really weird, but we can't give buttons to margins. So we have to use views to give margins. So let's add another style here. I will use margin left and margin right. But we can't see view, isn't it? Let's see the view, and I want to give colors to our views, and let's give a border width to see to our view. I will give 3. Then border color, let's use tomato. Very good. It goes under to screen, very normal. So I will use height and okay. This so much to these buttons. As you can see, it dynamically fits two buttons inside inside the div, inside view. There are different approach. As you know, we can write this code with various ways, but now I'm only trying to show something. So let's use border radius. We'll look. Yep, and let's add some, for example, onClick command to our buttons. We are gonna use arrow function here. First parameter, we can see first parameter from our IntelliSense, it is title. Second one is message. So I want to add another onPress event. Here is our buttons actions. You can write your algorithm, whatever you want. You can use another functions. You can navigate to another screens. So let's, for example, make, for example, this image is not clickable, clickable, isn't it? So clickable images are really important thing. So let's make this image clickable. This IntelliSense is really a second version. It is really intelligent. For example, if you write T or T and high, it directly gets opportunities, gets options. For example, touchable highlight is a UI element that makes UI elements clickable. Yeah, I check touchable highlight is here. After save, it formats our code. And here is image is clickable, but we can't feel any difference because there isn't any event. Let's write a click event here on press. Again, I would use an arrow function here. So our image became clickable, and there is an animation, embedded animation. It highlights to image after click. Emulator is very slow, so you can't feel the maybe difference, but in the normal hardware, it will be very fast, and it will be reasonably better performance. For example, this is our iOS version. Let me show you again. Yeah, here is our iOS version. I can click and there is an effect in the device. As you can see, it is very fast and it turn on lights after click to this one. So here is our button actions. Yeah, I think it is enough for now. We will prepare another event. We will call together, I think. We will practice together one by one in a couple of weeks later. I think, hope you like it. That's all for now. Thank you for listening.
Yeah, thank you so much, Gürhan. Yeah, of course, we will organize workshop about React Native because I want to use your React Native commercial experience. This is, it was only a small POC or small example.
Absolutely, yeah.
But it is...
we will talk about best practices that we are using in the industry. There are very valuable coding knowledge. So I want to share everything with you. But in this time, it is the maximum thing I can share. Meet everyone again.
Yeah, you know, there was so many other problem. There was, you know, internet problem, computer problem. Thank you so much. You didn't quit when you completed everything. And you are talking more than 2 hours. It is also a big challenge. And by the way, there was some question. Maybe we can make a short question and answer session.
Okay.
For example, one of the guys he asked, can we use Android Studio instead of browser stack for testing? Rashmi, he had asked.
Browser stack.
Yes.
We can use browser for testing. Yes. We can use another emulator programs. There are different versions of Android Studio. I can't remember now what was the emulator company. That is another industry standard.
Genymotion.
Sorry?
Genymotion.
Genymotion, yeah, absolutely. You can use these devices for your test that I used for Xamarin for example, I use GeneMotion. There are some other testing environments also.
I mean, I can. Hi, I'm Joseph. I can fill in on that. If you want to test it on a browser stack, you use Expo to compile the IPK or IPA. You upload that to browser stack, and then you need to create your test. You can create that natively using Express or whatsoever, and then you upload it there. You can use Appium, or you can use Detox, which is what you will normally use if you are creating a React Native application. But definitely you can do that.
Yep. Yeah, definitely you can do that. Is the question about these React Native producers IPA or IKA for Android and IPA for iOS? And for example, it doesn't matter, you are writing your applications with native language or cross-platform language, testing feature is same with native platforms because output is a native package. It is same with native technologies. As you know, GeneMotion can be used for every device testing, and besides there are some cloud opportunities. You can upload your package APK or IPA package to cloud, and you can do your cloud testing, for example. There are a lot of testing opportunities. If you have any questions about that, you can talk.
Yeah, Gürhan, one another question is Expo a Nugget package? We have any idea? I think the Nugget package
It's an NPM package, no?
NPM package and Yarn package can be used for our React Native libraries, and they are both very powerful, and they are improving their library set day by day. So Yarn and NPM packages can be used for the same with React JS actually.
I think the question is about the Expo package.
Yeah, there are two kinds of project creation method in React Native. One is React Native package, other one Expo package. Expo package is a little bit easier to use. There are some ready to use templates, and there are a lot of ready to use configuration files. Generally, if you search about React Native problems in the Google, majority of the developers are using Expo because it is ready to implement, but you can use React Native's own old school programming package too.
Thank you, Gürhan.
Any other question?
Yeah, any other question, guys?
I think it's been a great demo, by the way. Will the recording be available somewhere that we can just pick it up afterwards, or?
Yes, we will upload.
After this event, I will render and then I will publish on YouTube, and then I will share on the Meetup event wall its address, okay?
And the slides also, no, I assume?
Yes, we will share the slides. And if you wish, you can connect with us from LinkedIn. We will share this slide in our own profile, and it will be better to know each other I think everybody should connect.
Yeah, you can ask your question directly to Gürhan. Yeah, yeah. To be honest, you know, Gürhan really has impressive experience about React.js, also React. Yeah. Yes, another question, guys. Yeah, Semih, talk about talk a little bit. What do you think?
Yeah, I think it's been really good. Like, I'm to be honest, I'm changing my mind about Angular so much recently. I've been using Angular for a very long time, and yeah, after like these two sessions that Gürhan presented, I think it seems like you know, you can achieve more with React. It's really good. Thanks again, Gürhan.
Yeah.
You are welcome. No worries, Semi.
Yeah, guys, if you don't have any questions, I'm closing. This is your last chance. Yes. Yeah, you know, we will continue. You know, this this session will be, you know, periodic session, and every month we will do, you know, as a React Native seminar. And also after the event, I will organize workshop about the beginners, about the for the intermediate guys, for the advanced guys. Yeah, follow us. And by the way, if you need any help or any question, how to start, from where to start, if you don't have, you know, that kind of questions, do not hesitate to contact with us. And yeah, we are ready to help. And yeah, also follow our other events, because we are running so much trendy events, especially about microservice, about the hybrid clouds, about the React, Vue.js, and also asynchronous programming, serverless technology, and you can join all of them as a free, because we are the part of the UK COVID-19 supply catalog. We are doing also this kind of things voluntarily UK-wide. Yeah. Thanks. Thank you very much. And see you on our next event. Take care. Bye bye.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you again. Thank you. Thank you.
No problem. Thank you, Gürhan. Yeah. Thank you.